Hmm?
Go get it.
We are going to get started. I know some of you are still getting your lunch. Beth, step it up, will you? You're allowed to keep eating. Welcome to Ed Sessions 2.0. My name is Shay Anderson. I'll be moderating today's talk and the Q&A that follows. Does anybody want to have class outside? Feels like we're finally moved out of Seattle. The Ed Sessions 2.0 is brought to you by the J.A. and Catherine Albertson Foundation. The foundation is proud to sponsor the Don't Fail Idaho campaign, a statewide public awareness initiative to inspire an informed and productive conversation about education. You can find out more at don'tfailidaho.org. Now, as you guys know, those of you who are here don't need to worry about this, but these presentations are videocast live at theedsessions.org. We provide live streaming for one reason. News and information is instantaneous. The speakers here are bringing fresh content, no pressure, Jeannie, and material that's never been heard before, and people are hungry for it. But wait, there's more. We archive the presentations. You can watch these after any time. You can tell your friends, your school or business community, anybody who wants to watch these, who couldn't watch these sessions live, whether here at the lunch or online today, they can watch it at their convenience on our website, edsessions.org. And for those of you who are watching online, you can post questions to us via the Ed Sessions Facebook page. Did I mention we are on Facebook? You can do that at any time during this presentation. People will write them down. We've got people here who help you with this. They'll bring me the questions. We'll get them asked of our speaker here today. And unlike a lot of events, we ask you to keep your smartphones handy. Today, no text polling, so that those of you who get a little frustrated with the text polling, you're okay today. You get a break. But we're hoping to see some good tweets. We use the Ed Sessions hashtag here, so if you're on Twitter, use that. This isn't the Oscars. There will be no records broken for tweets with celebrity selfies. So as you know, each month, the Ed Sessions features a different education-related nonprofit that illustrates the Albertson Foundation's vision of limitless learning for all Idahoans. And this month, we're highlighting the Idaho Public Television. So if, like me, you're addicted to some form of their award-winning programming, whether it's Idaho Reports every Friday or Outdoor Idaho, which I was watching the promo for this morning. Nice work, you guys. It looks good. I asked Ron Pizaneski to join us here today and tell us a little bit more about Idaho Public Television. So everybody, please give an Ed Sessions welcome to Ron Pizaneski, the General Manager of Idaho Public Television.
Okay. So I need notes. Good morning. I'm Ron Pizaneski, or as our friends at the Oscars would say, now how did he do this? Ryan. In any case, I won't get into that. The screw up that John Travolta did with one of our singers. I'd like to thank the J.A. and Catherine Albertson Foundation for naming Idaho Public Television as today's featured nonprofit organization. Like the foundation, Idaho Public Television is focused on improving education and creating more widely available educational opportunities for Idaho's children and families. In fact, each weekday, we broadcast more than 12 hours of educational children's programming that has a demonstrated impact on children's school readiness and on their performance on standardized test scores. We broadcast that programming to give viewers in all corners of Idaho, regardless of their location or socioeconomic status. We also provide free of charge an online educational service for teachers and students featuring more than 30,000 resources that are searchable by subject, grade level, and state standards. For today, I've brought a brief video clip to share with you. This is from our newest Outdoor Idaho episode called Adventure Idaho. It's going to air Thursday evening as part of our March Festival fundraising campaign. Yes, that's going on now. Nearly 65% of our operating budget comes from private contributions, so this is an important time of year for us. If you haven't yet done so, I invite you to make a donation during festival now through March 16th. Now, that's okay. That's enough of the shameless plugs. As many of you know, Outdoor Idaho is our flagship local production. Each episode incorporates history, geography, and insight into relevant issues affecting our state and the environment. And it's all accompanied by stunning scenery of Idaho. We believe that this type of programming is one of the many ways we can inspire children and families to embrace Idaho's outdoor majesty and beauty while still being educated at the same time. And let's face it, Outdoor Idaho is just fun to watch. So I hope you'll enjoy this brief clip of the upcoming episode.
Lots of land under stars, skies above. You don't fence me in. Let me ride through the wide open country that I love. You don't fence me in. Let me be by myself. Listen to the murmur of the cottonwood trees. Tell me all forevermore, I'm begging you, please.
Everywhere you turn in this state of ours, you find adventure. You might say that Idaho's landscape beckons to the adventurous. Writer Ernest Hemingway came here in the 1950s, charmed by the possibilities. And he wasn't the only man of action to call Idaho home. Today's new camera technology allows us to document and celebrate our own adventure. Maybe it's to the top of an Idaho mountain, or to some obscure desert canyon. Maybe it's a walk around the entire state of Idaho in 100 days. Or maybe it's an adventure that doesn't quite go as planned. Outdoor Idaho explores the quest for adventure.
And Catherine Albertson Foundation, and each of you for the opportunity to be here today. My colleagues, Megan Griffin and Bruce Reichert, back there, are here with me, and we're happy to visit with you after today's presentation. So thanks again.
Thank you, Ron. He didn't tell you all the skiing footage was Ron. I have my own commercial here. I wanted to draw your attention today to something that's putting the new in Idaho education news. It's called Idaho Ed Trends. It's a great resource for anyone interested in how students and their schools are doing in Idaho. And the site is owned and managed by IdahoEdNews.org, a source of comprehensive journalism about public education and policy in practice here in Idaho. You can see a few images from the site here at the, on the screens. It's easy to use. And it's amazingly, no other state that we know of, Jennifer, correct me if I'm wrong, has done this yet. So we are treading new ground.
We're number one.
Okay. We don't hear that often here in Idaho, so we are number one in this. I appreciate that. All that you can see, all the data and the information on the site comes from the most recent publicly available data from agencies and entities such as the Idaho State Department of Education, the National Center for Education Statistics, and the National Student Clearinghouse. In short, the data relies on the same metrics and indicators to assess state, district, school, and student performance. And best of all, it's managed by a crackerjack team of Idaho education journalists, one of whom is joining us here today. I've already called her out, but Jennifer Swindell. Jen, can you just raise your hand so people know who you are? Jen's the managing editor of the site, so I've told her that anybody who wants to with their has brilliant suggestions for her on how to improve the site or questions on how it operates can talk to her after the show. But anyway, please thank you very much, Jen, for that work, and thank you, everybody, for checking it out later. I hope you will. Let me now introduce our speaker today, and this will take a little doing because Jeannie Allen is one of the most accomplished and tireless advocates for education reform. She founded the Center for Education Reform in 1993 and was president there through 2013. And prior to founding the center, Jeannie had roles at the U.S. Department of Education, the Heritage Foundation, and on Capitol Hill. She was recently named Vice President for Business Development at Hot Chalk, Incorporated, an education technology company. Jeannie serves on the board of Friendship Public Charter School in Washington, D.C., and the Challenge Charter School in Chandler, Arizona. She's on the Education Innovation Council of Arizona State University, an advisor to the University of Pennsylvania's Education Innovation Group, the D.C.-based Capital E, the Relay Graduate School of Education, and you see I'm turning pages for this. She was recently awarded the Working Mother called her one of the most powerful moms in education and the Black Alliance for Educational Options Champion Award in 2013. Jeannie has appeared on NBC, ABC, MSNBC, Fox News, CNN, NPR, national and local talk radio. She has published hundreds of articles and commentaries. She has one book, The School Reform Handbook, How to Improve Your Schools, and apparently she's working on another. Somewhere in there, she's found the time to raise four children with her husband. And we thank you, Jeannie, for squeezing in some time to visit us here in Boise. Let's please welcome Jeannie Allen.
Am I on? I forgot I'm on here, right? Can we all hear me? I want to make sure I didn't trip like the woman on the Academy Awards who got completely outed. Good afternoon, and thank you so much, Shay. Thank you, Jamie, and the Albertson Foundation, and distinguished leaders and friends in Idaho. I am delighted to be here today for a bunch of reasons. First and foremost, it is my favorite topic to talk about, and I'm grateful to you that you're interested. Second, it is so beautiful out here, and you have no idea what it looks like back east. So if any of you are heading out there, I'd suggest don't. Stay here, put up shop, if nothing else. And third, I believe, based on everything I know about the people in this room and beyond and the homework I've done ever since I was invited last year to be here, this is an amazing state with so much promise and opportunity. So in being invited here and talking to the folks who put Ed Sessions together and some of the predecessors and the people who have come before, I mean, were tremendous speakers, the question was really towards the what if parents reformed education? And that was music to my ears to think about because as a parent, as someone who came from parents, who didn't really know that they had any power, and as someone who's fought for a lot of with a lot of people, alongside of a lot of people, and taken courage from a lot of people to get power, I just thought this would be a great way to think about how really you can transform your education system. And so if we did think about if parents reformed education, what kind of view might they take, right? How can they galvanize their community? And given basic information, what would they do? I mean, if you actually said to parents, what if you reformed education? You take over. What kinds of rules and structures would they rethink? In fact, what would they actually start doing? And so what if we started all over? And that's really where I want to start with you. What would we do differently, right? If you were new to this planet, what would you think? I mean, think about it. What we have today is what we had over 100 years ago, right? What we have today is a system of schools tied together in school districts. It worked for most of this century. It's worked for many, many people. I remember early in my career, though, I grew up in a very nice middle-class community in upper New Jersey, up northwest New Jersey, and very small town. It was brand spanking new when my parents moved there. My dad was an Italian immigrant. And I remember shortly after I started working in education policy, I had my very first television interview, and it was on public television locally in Maryland. And I called my mother and I said, turn on, you know, I'm going to be on television. This is like the coolest thing in the world. I'm going to be talking about education. And I started telling the story because I had to justify why I was even talking about reform. Because back then, all right, this was the 80s, folks, there was no one really talking about education reform. And so back then, you had to justify, why are you talking about it? Aren't our schools the best in the world? What are you talking about? This is America. No one's really trying to reform education. I mean, charter schools were not even on the landscape at this point in time. We weren't talking about teacher issues. There were no issues about assessment. This was when everybody thought all of their schools are above average. And apparently, my mother thought so, too, because I went to this great school. I got lots of A's. I went to college. What I found when I went to college is, you know, real challenge at keeping up, quite frankly. And I'm on television telling the story about how even in my great school district, my above-average school district, I found after going to college I was actually paled in comparison to the level of learning elsewhere. And I got home, and my mother calls, and I figure she's going to say, you did great, Jeannie. That was so good. I'm so proud of you. Instead, she says, what are you talking about? You had the best education money could buy. And she starts yelling at me, and I'm like, Mom, no. I actually went to college and realized how little I knew compared to a lot of people who had a much higher caliber of education in the private system. And that's actually what spurred me initially to go on to this. So I used to say even to my own mother, who became my J&Q Public, God rest her soul, what would we do if we started over? You move to Allendale because of the schools. You open your doors. You said, go out the door. There you are. There was no reason for her to do anything else. There was no reason to engage her, to think about it differently, because as far as she knew, It had everything I possibly needed. And it did pretty good, right? So did they, obviously, that I could actually be here to talk about that. But there was a lot of chance there. There's a lot of hard work. That's a lot of grit. But my schools back then weren't the envy of the world. What if we were all the envy of the world? Today we know that we're not. And what if teachers and parents actually could have reset that and were in control of their own schools? What if real education reform came to Idaho? Real education reform. So why start over? You're probably sitting there saying, what are you talking about? We've got really good schools. We've got options. We have people working on it. We have Idaho Leads. We've got tremendous community support. What do we really have to start over? Don't we just have to just do a little bit here and there? Well, in a two-year period, only 13 states did worse than Idaho on NAEP. Two-year period. Only two. You have low college matriculation rates, as you know. You have high minimum wage workers, loss of productivity across the state. And that's not just about minority and poor children. It's about opportunity across the board. Okay? Idaho's gains were insignificant over a two-year period that the National Assessment of Educational Progress, which we call the nation's report card, measured progress. Take a look at this chart, okay? On the left, you have the national, all the states, 2011 through 2013, math and reading, fourth and eighth grade, or math, this is the math scores, the net increase or declines. By the way, this is almost identical for reading. And so just look at how that goes down. Even if you can't read it, on the left, look kind of it goes down. The top states, D.C., Tennessee, Indiana, Washington. On the right, I've kind of segmented where Idaho is. 0.08, less than 1% growth over time, right? Growth's an important thing. You can grow from 90% to 96%. It could be the difference between your success and failure as a person. You can grow from 30% to 40%. But in every single state and community on the upper left-hand corner right there of the chart that had real high-quality opportunities for families, those are the states that had the most opportunities, the most real education reform. And so I ask you, what does it take to get Idaho to that level? And why do the experience of those other states matter? I mean, think about it just in the aggregate, okay? You are part of this country, right? Every state's part of this country. Fewer than 40% of our nation's fourth and eighth graders actually achieve at proficiency in math and reading. And frankly, if you go down the list, civics, geography, history, science, the numbers are actually worse. If you disaggregate the data, yes, more advantaged Anglo-white students tend to do better, but not so much when you compare them to the best achieving kids in other states, even the other countries. The worst achieving kids in other countries, our kids barely are beating them as well, okay? We have a snapshot in this country where we may all be doing better than we once were, but better is no longer good enough. Think about this, 15 states in this country, 15 states do not have a single traditional school district in the top third of math achievement compared to other developed countries. Only 9% of all U.S. school districts had an average student rank in the top third compared to other developed countries. And these numbers, and others like them, exist despite lots of effort. And I urge you, even though I have isolated Idaho on the right, so you could see where you sit, I would urge you to always think in terms of the rest of the country, because this is increasingly not just a state, a global state, it's a global nation, it is a global world. And in fact, the great things about our nation, the things that make progress possible, is that we can learn from one another. You know, I've had this extraordinary luxury all my life, and you've heard from people in these sessions before who bring this interesting perspective. I've got to travel around, right? I get to go to states and learn about how people have done things differently. I get to talk to people, teachers and educators and parents and all sorts of folks like you about what actually has moved the dial. And every place where something really great has happened, they got the idea somewhere else. Right? How many of you have heard that? There's not really any new ideas out there. It's the implementation that's typically different, right? It's how you did it and how you got there. And it's getting ourselves out of this notion that right now, in this space and time, we're doing everything we possibly can. Indeed, we are not. Otherwise, not only would Idaho be up at the top of that chart in terms of progress, because we can all make progress, we can all be better in a finite period of time, right? But the rest of the country would be as well. And a rising tide does lift all boats. So again, why start over? Why am I here telling you this? Because transformation literally requires it. We are past reform. Okay, reform is what we started 20 years ago. Education reform was about changing the way we do business in the current mindset. Okay? And go back to that initial, what if parents reformed education? What would that take? Our current mindset across the country, think about this, the reform, the education reform, many of which you, people like Tom Luna, your leadership here, have brought to this state, is tremendous. But transformation requires us to dig deeper and move mountains. And those states at the top of the game are making progress because they reset the clock. They're not just bringing iPads in class. They're not just putting computer labs in class. They're literally pursuing the most amazing innovations of technology. Some of those states have schools where students are being taught history from someone sitting at Stanford University in real time, or math from a professor in Singapore, or business and leadership acumen booming into leaders through technology from a whole nother country. I mean, innovation technology where not only is learning on your hands, I mean, how many of us know someone who doesn't walk around with a phone or with a pad accessing what's going on every day? The amount of information that we transmit through technology in our own lives outside of school is incredible to measure and think about. And yet, when it comes to innovation technology in schools, we have these debates. Like it's something brand new. How can someone learn online? Oh my gosh, you're gonna put them in front of a computer. I'm sorry, but I remember reading the clips last year over that whole initiative to put every high school have to have online classes. And the fact that there were parents that were like, oh, we don't want our kids to learn from technology. Hello, what are we talking about here? They do use technology. I took my leadership class at Penn last semester with this phenomenal leadership professor, this guy from Wharton, who was talking about how actually we have to get over this, right? I was one of those parents, by the way. I was like, oh, I'm sorry, the TV's turning off, you're not allowed technology after 8 o'clock. If I see you texting on your phone when you're not doing your homework, like, you're out of here. No, they don't talk to me, right? But this is what I did as a parent, so I totally get it. And then, like, he opened up my mind because he was talking about that actually students really are so much more proficient at accessing knowledge and communicating. They have a new level of sociability. They actually have demonstrated to us, our young people, that just being in front of technology doesn't mean they're less sociable. They know lots. I have this raging debate with my 22-year-old. I'm like, Teddy, you used to read. He's like my brilliant guy. He's my musician. He's kind of out there, right? You guys should relate in Idaho. You got a lot of these people running around. I have this raging debate. I don't see you picking up books anymore. He was reading when he was two. He goes, Mom, I know stuff. I'm looking at it. And literally, he can tell me what's going on and who's saying what and how it compares to what people are doing elsewhere. When I walk into classrooms across the country that are using technology to beam in knowledge, those kids are mobilized. They are moving education on their own. They know how to keep pace. Our students know how to educate themselves with support from great educators. But unless we literally unlock those doors and let that innovation thrive, we're not even scratching the surface. Expansive learning opportunities. States that have reset the dial on education reform have expanded learning opportunities by leaps and bounds. They have not only introduced charter schools, they've made sure that charter schools are part of the ecosystem in every single community. Take Indiana, who's our number one on our Parent Power Index, okay? They not only have expansive charter school learning opportunities, they have other forms of school choice. They allow people to access technology, private school learning, and course by course selection above and beyond. They have post-secondary enrollment, where you can actually get credit for being in high school and going to college at the same time, shortening the amount of time you've got to spend later. Because the other thing we know about our young people is they're impatient, they want results now. We're not going to change the way they act. We've got to move with them. We've got to shift with them. States like Indiana, Florida have adopted policies to push the envelope. They have pushed the boundaries of what it means to have reform. Teaching and leadership. They've actually taken a look at some of the same issues here that you've looked at and that you're moving towards, but not enough, right? They've looked at why is tenure an issue? Why are we talking about teachers and pay and salary and benefits at this level? Why aren't we talking about what is the learning encounter about. If education is about learning, then who's in front of our kids? And if we put people called educators in front of our kids, what's the best way to motivate and stimulate them? It's not to talk about pay and benefits. It's to say, what's your value? What do you want to do? What is your job? And then you put the pay and benefits to their job, right? You take our leaders and our educators and you value them for what they do. And if that's $40,000 because you want to be part-time and you want to come teach science, but Mike, you want to be there round the clock, 12 hours a day, and on Saturdays, and by the way, you want to actually help lead the after-school program too, let's give you $100,000. God bless you, and give you a bonus on top of that when you raise that stakes for those kids, right? Let's accelerate what we mean by education with new expansive learning opportunities for kids and new ways of thinking about teaching and leadership. So why do we have to start over? Because every single bill that you're talking about today in your legislature, God bless them, and across this country, it is not just Idaho, is based on what's already in law, right? We start with the document. We start with a system that's already baked. We start with rules. And everything the legislature passes has to be modified, has to be codified, has to be labeled, right? It has to go into a rule. A state superintendent has to hire people to manage that rule. Now you've sent it down to the superintendents. Now they've got not only 100 pages of rules, they've got to add more. They've got to figure out where to tweak it, where to put it, how to account for it. So you can pass a great reform at the state level, but unless you completely reset the dial, it's not going to end up where you think it's going to end up, because you have to actually fundamentally start over. And that brings me to the piece about accountability. Look, accountability across this country is broken. Okay, we have more data than ever before about our kids, and yet we like struggle with how to measure. But yet, what is accountability? Accountability is simply saying, you got some money, it's the public's money, we want to know how you're measuring whether you're succeeding or not, so we can decide whether or not we raise the level for you, we expand you, we bring in support, or maybe we do close you down. Because guess what, folks? That has to happen sometimes. Because not one child in this country should be in a school that is failing them. And if they don't have an option and you're failing a lot of kids, something's not working. Because we know what works in schools. We know it's great leaders. We know it's great educators. We know it's great curriculum. But all those people have to be free to pursue the course of action they need best. So we know that. But whatever is that prescription, unless we are measuring in real time how students are doing, then we can't measure how teachers are doing compared to how those students are doing, and we can't hold the schools accountable because we really don't know fundamentally what we're shifting into. We don't really know what those data sets mean. So I talked a little bit about parent power. We measure parent power in a few ways, okay? We measure parent power by how many expansive opportunities they give parents to actually make some choices. We measure parent power by whether the state has transparency in real data, the kind of data I was talking about. Gosh, I love EdTrends, but I've been all over EdTrends. I followed EdTrends to the Department of Education. This is not Tom Luna's fault, by the way. I could not find out half the information I needed to find out about how kids were doing and how you all measure growth. If I can't find it, and I've been in this business a really long time, I guarantee you a parent is not going to stay in there and try to figure out how that's a measurement, right? And those are things I know you're working on. These are all moving parts, and it's not one person. It's a whole system and stuff. But transparency, I can go to the Indiana Department of Education website. I can go right to the school my child goes to. I know their letter grade. I know what the letter grade means. I know how many teachers in the school. I know how many kids are in the school. I know how many black, white, and everything else are in that school. I know everything about the school. I know how much funding it's getting. I know how it's being measured, and it's real-time data. And as a parent, I feel empowered if I'm in an Indiana, a Florida, a Ohio, a Louisiana, because I can do that. That's transparency. It's all those pieces. We also measure parent power based on, again, learning, expansive learning opportunities, and teacher quality. We define teacher quality initiatives, not by whether or not you absolutely know that teacher's a quality teacher, but whether or not you have things in place that seek to attract teachers based on their qualifications, reward them based on their performance as well as their skills and responsibilities, hold them accountable, and elevate them as they grow. So those combined make up our parent power. So you're not in the top 10, as you can see, the 1 through 10. Idaho's number 19, which isn't bad, right? Because it's better than most states. But 19 is a 68 by anyone's measure. That's not really good. And we can argue about grades all day long, but I'll tell you, we're not the only national group that grades states. And there's not one state out there that's got Idaho in the top 10, okay? And most of them are between the 15 and 20. And the graduation rate, as someone pointed out yesterday, this is from 2012, 72%. It's actually 80%, even according to diploma counts. But I'd say even 20%, you know, that we're not graduating. And let's just say of the 80% we're graduating, half of those kids are probably not getting the world-class education they deserve. I'm just going to be honest with you. We're just going to have a big truth session here, because this is not why you don't come here to hear someone tell you how wonderful it all is, right? Yes, we're doing great. I love that. I mean, I have to encourage my kids. We have to encourage our colleagues. I have to encourage staff. We're doing great. But sometimes you actually have to open it up, look at the dial, and say, where are we? Okay? You're not where you need to be. You've made such progress, though. I mean, Idaho really, again, I kind of feel bad that you're down at 19. I want to raise you, especially since you're all really nice, and I like you a lot, and you have been trying. But the reality is you could do so much more. I said to someone the other day, it's a small state. Oh, my gosh, I would kill to be here for an extended period of time. I'm not looking for a job, Jamie, I promise. But I really would love to be here because it's small. Yes, it's expansive, but you have so much to work with. You are so interested. You are so engaged. You have so many great institutions on the ground. Imagine if we started over. So, again, why do we measure parent power? The public wants power. There's not one. Is there anyone here who doesn't want to have some power of their life when they wake up that wants to? Anybody? Right? You don't want power. You probably want someone to tell you what to do. I know. There's always one of you in every group. What do you do for a living? Okay, all right, good, good. You want power. All right, good. I was going to say, what do you do for a living? I'd love your job. I would love not to have power sometimes. But the public wants power. So the Center for Education Reform did a survey, annual survey of America's attitudes towards education. We actually asked the question this time. Instead of just asking these, like, really high level, I know you guys have polled people. Everyone loves stuff. But you actually start digging down. Do you know what it means? 46%, not huge, but a plurality, say they need more parent power in their children's education. Interesting. Let me tell you why I think more don't want power. Because I'm going to go back to my mother. They really don't understand what that means. Most people, when you ask them if they want power, it means you got to do something, right? It implies action. I don't have time for power. I just want to send my child to a good school. And parents, indeed, do want to send their kids to a good school. In fact, fully 71% said they'd move if their child was not successful, and underperforming schools propel 67% of people to say that they would go somewhere else. This is huge, by the way. I don't have a slide in this, but when we did the same survey 6 years ago, the majority of people surveyed, same groups, by the way, and this crosses demographics, it's also tripartisan, we like to say, but of all these people we surveyed, they said safety and proximity to their home or their community was the most important thing. It used to be safety. I'm going to move my kids because if they're not safe, man, we're out of here. Moral and ethical considerations had something to do with it. Now it's performance. That is a tremendous thing for us to build on across this country. I credit the media in helping us have accomplished that, because the media actually have covered these issues more than before about performance. But the media wouldn't be covering if it wasn't for the actual real live reform efforts, the schools, many of you represented in this area, and the superintendents who've gotten on board for this, kicking and screaming, some of them, but God bless you, those of you who've come along, right? But now people are talking about performance. It used to be it was a dirty word. I am not kidding you. In the beginning of the Center for Education Reform in the 1990s, I would go to audiences and talk to people. I would be on television or writing about something, talking about teacher quality, talking about choice and content and accountability. And people are like, oh, how dare you? Are you saying that our teachers aren't doing a good job? No, I just said we could do better and we should be talking about quality. Now performance is the flavor du jour. Celebrate that. Build on it. People want it. And they want to follow it, which means everything you do, communicated well, informed well, able to track that performance, people will be on board with what you do. So parent power is critical. This was real parent power. This is a Time magazine cover story, 1994. That little boy is in a charter school in Michigan. This was parent power and grassroots work at its best. I've had this discussion with a bunch of you just in the very brief time I've been here, what, like all of 24 hours? But it's not unlike what I've talked to a lot of people around the country, which is how do we move the dial? How do we get people engaged? How do we get them powerful? How do we effectuate reform? How do we communicate and accelerate the pace of education reform? How do we transform? How do we do what if? Well, let me tell you something. The reason this covers up there, this was one of the most exciting times for education in this country. It was painful for a lot of people. But real, live, ordinary, normal parents actually are the ones who created the education reform movement. It wasn't, with all due respect, Senator, I see you moved in, it wasn't legislators. They actually did what parents asked them to do, right? It was parents who took it upon themselves to say, enough. We've now seen the data. We now have kids coming home that have those straight A's. They were coming home in 1994. I'll never forget a call I got. It actually might even be in the school reform handbook. A call I got from a parent in Oregon who said, is this happening elsewhere? My child came home with a pack of multiplication cards with a note that said, please do this at home. We will not be doing it in class. Okay, these were the days of fuzzy math, whole language, not really, sort of loosey-goosey. It was lots of fads, and it was really not a lot happening. And parents said, enough, our kids aren't learning enough. They're not going where they need to be. We really want to take back our schools. People aren't listening. They started this movement. And this was a cover story in Time magazine because the first thing that happened after Michigan was the fourth or fifth state to enact charter schools, maybe the third or fourth state to enact charter schools, is they were sued. Charter school laws were sued in 15 states over the course of the last 15 years by state school boards associations saying they were unconstitutional. So there was a big article about this, and this was a great story because actually this school eventually went out of business because it had a fight. Those parents who fought to get that law, who this article centered on, who was at the center of this lawsuit, went out of business, like many of them. In fact, many schools tend to go out of business because they actually are not only focused on leading their school, making sure it's all working, but they're looking behind them at all the arrows that are coming. And it's still a very political battle. But real parent power in real grassroots wasn't started anywhere else but at the grassroots level. It's really a most amazing story if you think about it, and it's the way to actually re-transform and reset the clock. And yes, there were governors and legislators who absolutely followed suit. So again, why start over? Let's go back to that lesson. There was nothing else happening, and those parents said, we want to take back our schools. We want to do this thing called charters. Charters were the initial idea. That transformation didn't happen overnight, but those seeds were planted long ago. And this movement now has a history from which to learn. And I'd like to say, with all due respect to my friend Michelle Rhee and President Obama, the reform didn't start with them. It started with the parents who were covered in that. In fact, it started 10 years before that. It started when we had and realized there was a nation at risk that many of us woke up to. And that famous line, realized we were a rising tide of mediocrity. Okay? But those people, those parents all across the country who brought you your reforms, I was flipping through my notes to prepare to get here, and my current hard drive, and there's another one I haven't plugged in, with Communication to Idaho goes back to 1998. And we have emails from Paul Powell, who was a business leader here. Does anyone remember him? Okay, who then was on the school commission, who was trying to get your law, your charter law reset. We have communications from many of the earliest founders of charter schools, the Coeur d'Alene, Idaho charter schools. We have data on the lawsuits. We have arguments between the districts about why they kept denying all these schools. You know, you stand on the shoulders of these phenomenal people who've created this great history. But like every movement, whether it be the movement for more opportunities for children in schooling and charters and choice, whether it be to help teachers and administrators, whether it be curriculum, whether it be technology, we all get comfortable. We all think we're doing as much as we can. We're running in place. What else could we possibly do? Well, I would argue there's a ton more. And we do not have a generation to waste. So whether your community has people who are at the 75th percentile, let's talk about getting them to the 90th. Or if they're at the 30th percentile, let's get them up. Or if they're just simply not graduating college at the rate or matriculating to college, let's move it. We had a discussion this morning that Terry Ryan helped lead with some charter schools, and we were talking about the notion that how do you actually take a state like yours that has so much financial, very low revenue base, right? and really increase the amount of time and effort you're spending on schools, equalize the playing field for everybody. Well, when schools get better, communities grow. People want to find opportunities to be in this. People want to find great schools, and when you build opportunities for them, they come to the state. Businesses come to the state. People invest in the state. So I was talking about history. This is sort of a signature project, the Center for Education Reform, a really, really tawdry commercial ed reform university. But I'll tell you what, we realized over time that the biggest difference between states that did a great job and states were doing so-so was not understanding history, the history of this whole movement, where it came from, who did it, what's going on. So there are literally tens of thousands of documents we've started stockpiling from our computers, personal communications, strategic plans, discussion points, and what we're found, you know, it's sort of everything old is new again. The exact same conversations we're having today, we were having 20 years ago. And the people who have made progress, the ones who pushed beyond it, who made that change, who in fact said, what if parents reformed education? What if we started over? What if we looked at things differently? So again, what has to change here? Let's get really specific. A lot. Your charter school law, it is moderately strong. We rank it as a B, but there's still a lot of restrictions to getting there. You guys have made a lot of progress. I love the fact that universities now can become authorizers. They're going to get educated thanks to your charter network in the next couple of weeks. When they go visit other universities, universities are such phenomenal authorizers around the country. But what tends to happen with every charter school movement and what we've seen and heard here, both from schools as well as potential applicants, is the charter school movement is so busy doing its work that it forgets that sometimes there's lots of onerous regulations and rules and processes that you're expecting not only applicants but existing schools to jump through. We're not revisiting equity enough. We're not looking at the leveling that playing field. What is money about? Money is about educating the public. How are we making sure that everyone involved in that charter enterprise is actually paying for the education that parents are choosing to send their kids to? So what's a great charter law? It's one that has lots of authorizers. You're well on your way there. Fiscal equity. No child should be counted with different dollars. Just because you're in one community doesn't mean you should be worth something from a different community. Do you have lots of autonomy? Is there room to grow? Is there an ability to say, I've got something great going on here, I want to extend it across the community or across the state? Your charter school law needs that. There's not enough choices for all students. There just aren't. It's not just the waiting list kids. This is not just a charter discussion. There are people who want to be homeschooled. There are people who want to be in a virtual school. There are people who want to go to a private school. There might be things we've never even thought of. Who ever heard of the word charter before 1991, right? There might be things we're not even pushing ourselves to think about. Opportunities to make choices come about when you engage parents and real live people in the development of proposals, and ideas happen from there. Learning, ground, and technology, it's still considered fringe. Again, how many of you don't say yourself, come on, admit it, or live near someone or have a conversation and says, okay, but don't they not get socialized? Do we really want them at home? Are they really doing a good job? You know, I keep having these discussions with people across the country who are in online schooling, whether it's blended or the traditional virtual schools. And, you know, they're under a lot of pressure, as we all should be, to demonstrate results. But a really interesting thing happens when you actually have choice. A lot of us didn't grow up with the ability to make a choice. We don't really know what that is. We might be great consumers in every other part of our life, right? But learning how to make a choice is something that comes with practice. I made a bad decision, I got to change. You know, I didn't move the right house, I didn't pick the right car, I didn't pick the right husband, I don't know. Whatever it happens to be, I didn't pick the right neighbor, I picked bad food, whatever it is. But when it comes to fundamentally working with people in relationships and picking a school, parents are smart about their child. They may not know everything, but they know what is better. They know what that looks like. I've been to a lot of communities across the country, and I'll never forget this one experience in Washington, D.C. several years ago. And I know you're not Washington, but it doesn't matter, and that's what this woman was saying. It was a group of inner-city parents gathered to talk about school choice. I was there to help them understand the choice. And there I was, you know, was sort of fairly new into my tenure doing what I do, and I was talking to them, and I slowed down because they were parents. And they were black, white, all sorts of different shapes, sizes, formulas. And I just started talking like this. And I said, so this is what this program would do. And I started talking, and this one woman raises her hand and says, you know, we may not come from where you are, but we can get to where you're going. You can speed it up. We're not stupid. I was like, you know what? I will never forget that woman as long as I live, because she taught me a valuable lesson. And every parent I have met that has ever been engaged in the learning enterprise with their child, once given a choice, we don't have to tell them what to ask. We have to sometimes explain to them the data, because it may not be as clear as it needs to be. But if you say to a parent, there's an opportunity for your child to get a great education, you live so far from a school, and you can do it virtually, and you're going to probably have to weigh in there, and you're going to probably have to figure out the technology, they're going to figure it out, and they do. But we've got to allow it. We have to be permissive with our laws so these things can happen. And technology of all sorts. Again, whether it's on a pad, or whether it's boomed in somewhere else, or whether it's different kinds of learning environments, a few people here, a few people there, and then coming together occasionally, there is no limit to what people can do when they are left to their own devices, held accountable, and given opportunities to thrive in the learning process. Policy discussions around teachers, again, I've already alluded to this, they are consumed by pay and benefits. I wouldn't want to be a teacher anywhere where the constant discussion is pay and benefits. Yes, at the end of the day, you have to reward people and pay them. But let's talk about what is your role in the learning process and how can we help you become better, bigger, and more involved? How can we make sure that could be literally the best profession in the world? The data systems, again, still in their infancy. They ignore the nuances, real-time growth. If I could leave you with nothing else, if we disagree about teacher tenure, performance pay, choices for kids, please, data is critical. And there is no reason that we shouldn't know where every child is at any given time and space. Some of the best data systems in the country happen to be at charter school authorizers that are running universities, because they've actually had lots of freedoms. And I have seen data systems where they can actually see in real time and pull up how not only the school is doing, but how teachers in each of the individual classrooms, how kids' achievement is tracking with those individual teachers and where they are. They can see who's absent, who's not, what some of the problems are, all right there, protected, okay? Not out shared with the whole world, protected. It happens, you can do it, you can see it, and then you can manage it. You cannot manage what you can't measure, and you cannot measure what you do not collect. It is essential. So you have those, you have the tools, you can get there. And then finally, what else has to change? Public is unaware. This is complicated stuff. It's hard to explain this stuff. It is not easy. We've got to like pare it down to sound bites. And we're all guilty of it. We're all guilty of talking in policy jargon and expecting people know what we're talking about. We're all really in a hurry. But it really is important to explain what it is we're trying to do, why opportunities are important, why transformation is really important. So the good news, right? Idaho leaders are in the game. There is progress. Look at you all here. You've got organizations. You've got the task force. You've got the charter network. You've got Ed Trends. You've got Education News. You've got reform groups converging. It's a small state. What, it costs like $5 to do an ad on like some television station? This is not big stuff. Someone here is probably a neighbor of the legislator, right? I mean, I bet you Senator Mortimer has a lot of people in this room that vote for him. Or maybe not. But you have to help them. I don't know. But the reality is on that. So Janet Barisi is the state superintendent of public instruction in Oklahoma. I have lots of favorite stories. This is one of my favorite stories. Janet was just a parent. This is in the transcript for the 20th anniversary of CER that'll be out soon. I was hoping to have brought it today. But Janet was just a parent who called us out of the blue. Why'd she call us? People always say, how do parents reach you? Because we make our business to be in the media, not so my mug could be on TV or my name in the paper or my successors, but so people find us, right? So media is the key. And we've gotten to know lots of people because of the media. And then it gives us credibility because otherwise people don't talk to us if the news doesn't print it, because somehow, as you know, in the media, that's everything. Anyway, Janet Barisi calls out of the blue one day. This is back in the mid-90s. I'm a parent. I'm unhappy with my school. I was reading about this online. I'd really like to do something with charter schools. Can you come to my state and help us figure this out? And back then, we just used to go on a plane and go anywhere where someone was breathing and interested. So I went to Oklahoma, and I'm sitting down with Janet. She says, you know, I'm having this conversation with Sandy Garrett. Sandy Garrett was the elected state superintendent of public instruction in Oklahoma. Sandy Garrett was a Democrat. Sandy Garrett was sort of interested. I'm having this conversation. I really want her to come along and let her know this isn't some right-wing crazy idea to actually give parents control of their own education. So I want you to meet Sandy Garrett. How do you know Sandy Garrett? I'm her dentist. Janet Parisi was a dentist. And Sandy Garrett would be in the chair, and Janet was like, you know, Sandy, I really have to, I need help. This is how it happened. So we go to Oklahoma. I meet with Sandy Garrett. Sandy Garrett lays out how we're going to actually talk to legislators. And literally, she walks in the legislature, and she says, well, see that guy over there? You need to go to him because he likes cute little brunettes. He likes guns. You go talk to him. I'm going to go talk to this one. And like, women can do amazing things, by the way, when they fan out in the legislature. And we went and talked to all these people. And at the end of the day, a bunch of legislators came together and were talking about how best to convince people that charter schools are a great idea for Oklahoma. And it turns out, so we start asking, so who do you know in your area that might be an educator? Who do you know that might be for this? And it turns out, like, this legislator's cousin actually has been thinking about starting a new school. This one does something else. It turned out when you actually start doing an inventory, all these people knew someone who was on board. And Janet went to work all on her own to organize people to eventually pass the state law in Oklahoma. She then created the first charter school, and then she went back to work as a dentist because she was kind of done. And a few years later, I get a note from her in this last decade saying, I'm running for state superintendent of public instruction. She won, and everything she learned when she was doing that, she has put to work. Janet was just a parent. There are hundreds of those examples across the country of people who have actually put their work to use for better once they actually got themselves tied in there. And so it's good news what's happening here, and you have to find those jewels who are going to help you crusade. You have to make sure your legislators have the information they need to get the job done. You have to help them build a fire in their belly, quite frankly, so that they can move that. So what's the challenge, right? It's engaging people. It's figuring out how, in Janet's parlance, in that example, how you get people to the next level. And parents and parent rights are paramount. I cannot emphasize this enough. Yes, they're busy. Yes, they don't know necessarily everything. Yes, they can't navigate it. Once you put them at a table and ask them to help, they will be there. You must educate and inform them as policies are being developed, not after it's happened. We've talked about this. Not after you have the bill and say, will you support me? Sit down and have them understand how policy is done. It is law and sausage. It is absolutely that monarch, right? It is really difficult to see being done, but if you bring people in the policy equation, they will always be on board. There must be a sense of urgency. I'm just going to go back to my Band-Aids. You can't keep adopting policies that are built on top of other policies that are intended to liberate people. It's easier actually to start from scratch. You probably have a lot less paper, senators here and others. You just need to look at how are we doing business. Fundamentally, can we get money behind kids? I mean, that wonderful, wonderful visual. If every child in this state and in America, quite frankly, were worth the same amount of money, and they came to you with that money in a backpack, strapped to your back, and you had a vie for the privilege of getting that backpack of money off of my child's shoulders. You had a vie for the privilege of educating my child. You want to see how things would transform really quickly? That is the way to get people's attention. It is that backpack funding, they call it. They call it weighted student funding. It's money following kids. And guess what? Most people out there think that's the way money works. It is shocking when you talk to real people and you explain to them, no, money comes to districts and there's formulas and they have this kind of per pupil and there's a foundation, then there's this grant and that grant and there's this stream, that stream. They don't understand why. They don't get it. And they shouldn't, because it doesn't make any sense anymore. It's not good for districts. It's not good for superintendents who, of course, have to do this and hold their money, right? Because if you take money, they can't see where it's going to go. If you change that equation, if you start having money truly transform, follow the money, you will start seeing not only districts working with charter schools, working with other opportunities, creating new innovations, because you can see where that money moves. And there must be a plan that recognizes that parents don't just get organized and educated in one legislative session. This can take years, but you've got to build it and you've got to reform it. three suggestions. I shared this yesterday with some state legislators. Embrace choice fully, not full. Resist the temptation to overregulate. Fully means everyone gets an opportunity to decide what the best place for their child is. It might be the traditional public school, it might be a charter public school, it might be private, it might be online. Again, I'm like a broken record. It's really important. Get it in here. Reset the accountability system. Create truly new ways to support teaching and leadership professions. We cannot do it without them. Guess what? They don't want to be part of one great big organization at the state or national level. They don't want to be teachers and superintendents, you know, the biggest no-no-no-nos, right? They want to be part of something positive. But the reason they defer their association and their leadership organizations that have really big organizations, and I'm sorry, I'm not offending anyone here, Idaho and Washington, everywhere else, is because they don't have time to figure it out. You bring them into the process early, rank and file teachers and superintendents like parents. We're there at the beginning. They're the ones who have been figuring this out along. When great things happen, it's because of them. In conclusion, you can be number one if enlist parents organically and put them in the lead. Educate the public and the media on what is possible. Isn't this cool? I had all these E's. I was so proud of myself. Embrace technology and innovation. Expand choice. Elect people who walk the talk. If Senator Mortimer's not going to do it, don't elect him again. Right? I mean, right? If you're not going to stand up and do what the people here want, you, exactly. Give him a suitcase. Evaluate continually what you do. I'm so much fun picking on you. Continually what you do and if it's working. What you do. What you personally are doing, evaluate. And what your school is doing. And by the way, if you're an association head or where's Terry? Evaluate what you're doing. Are you really doing the best you can do? Is the Albertson Foundation doing the best they can do? Evaluate what you were due. Challenge yourself, the status quo and reformers. We've had education reform, and then reform became the status quo. We got to move off of the status quo. We've got to get to the next level. And you do that, you've got to unleash and do all of these things. Reformers are standing by to assist. Thank you.
That's a shame she's so shy and retiring. Can we? We're going to take a short break, give her a chance to breathe, and then I want everybody at their tables, you have a chance to write questions down with people who are circulating throughout the audience to take those questions up here to me. I'll do my best to fire them at Jeannie, who will probably fire right back. Bonus points if you use the Ed Sessions branded notebooks that are at your tables. If I see a few of these, that'll be great. I'll ask those first. Otherwise, so take a few minutes, write some questions, talk amongst yourselves, as they say, and we'll get back to those questions. Thank you.
I am a little beggar man, a beggin' I have been for 80 and more in this little island green. I'm known from the Liffey down to Cebu, and I'm known by the name of old Johnny Doo. Of all the trades that's going, I'm sure begging is the best. For when a man is tired, he can sit down and rest. He can beg for his dinner, he has nothing else to do. Only cut around the corner with his old rig-a-doo. I reckon that diddly I can reckon that and die. Back over the fields with me great heavy sack with holes in me shoes.
shoes and me toes sleeping through, singing skinny rinkadoodle-o and old Johnny Doo. I must be going to bed, for it's getting late at night. The fire's all rigged and out goes the light. So now you've heard the story of me old rig-a-doo. It's goodbye and I'll be with you, says old Johnny Doo.
Don't worry about it. Okay, everybody, we're going to get rolling on some questions and answers. I wanted to also make sure, and hey, Nice work, everybody, writing on your notepads. I wanted to also highlight, at your table, you've got postcards that highlight the Idaho Ed Trends product that's available through Idaho Ed News. Jennifer Swindell, as I mentioned before, will be here after the talk. At this table, you get to move a chair or two if you want. But she'll take you through the site because it was developed and designed to engage parents, just what Jeannie here is talking about. So the data is available in an easy-to-use format. I can verify that as a non-math guy. Sorry, I can make it through the site perfectly well. So I validate that. We have a pile of good questions, and I'm proud to say we've got a question from Twitter in here as well. I love that. Keep scribbling. We'll answer them as we go. Jeannie, I'm just going to punt through a few of these here. One of the first ones that came to me was, how does Common Core play into this whole question of engagement and reform? Because we were having that debate here in Idaho. Is it an advance or a setback in the effort to reform Idaho schools?
So, totally want to answer that. I do have to make one clarification, though. I mentioned Ed Trends, and then I really quickly went to how the Education Department's data is bad. Inadequate, not bad. It's only what you can get out. Ed Trends links to the department. It was the department's website I was talking about that had the actual data, had actual formulas and stuff on it. So, I think Common Core is fascinating. I think Common Core is here to stay. I think it's based on a lot of really good science and data about content. And I think every school should be able to determine best how to put it to use. The way it really plays into this is without that flexibility and without that accountability locally for what happens locally, we lose the whole purpose of education reform. So I've told a lot of my friends who are big leaders and proponents of Common Core that it's becoming a little bit of a distraction. And there's a reason that there are people who are opposed. And I said, Thane is one of them. I know there's a lot of people who are concerned about it. I think they could alleviate some of those concerns if they really help them understand that we should be driving results locally and that educators should be empowered and leaders should be empowered to use it as best they can. And then those measurements, which we've always had, by the way, we've always had tests, they're not always great, that this is an opportunity to actually make measurements better and more effective. But those actual content pieces should be part of the discussion. They shouldn't drive everything we're doing.
Great. Let me ask this other one, another Idaho-centric question. What does your model, your reform model look like in Idaho, where we have many small and rural districts?
Well, so that's the most exciting part of it, is when you actually have the kinds of choice and accountability across the state, if you allow for people to start autonomous schools or for existing schools and school districts to become highly autonomous, but all again connected with standards, assessments that are locally driven. If you have those things in place, what happens is dynamic schools open up. Schools can expand, schools can set up in rural communities. The answer for rural education is not to keep the way it is, it's to actually open up a marketplace. Because there are people who would indeed take over buildings or connect people through technology or maybe have a hybrid model where you're actually going to a couple of different places for an education. And so real reform, when it occurs, really does bridge the gap between suburban, rural, and urban.
Okay, here's another question. If education legislation was rewritten from scratch, what would the key components of the new landscape be?
Money follows kids. I think you start with that. I think that's really at the core of it. And then there are a lot of other things, and I'm available for hire if you want me to rewrite your education code.
She's taking calls.
Really not.
I have a couple of questions along the same lines, but this one I think articulates it best. How do you plan to educate parents who are not engaged?
So I'd say parents aren't engaged. The parents that aren't engaged because they don't know what's possible. When you present an option, parents rise to the occasion. When there is no option, there's absolutely no reason to do anything and to not be part of it. So, you know, the other piece of this is, if I'm a parent and I show up at a school who has absolutely no power to affect change in my child's life, then I'm gonna stop showing up. So I go to the principal's office. I don't know if this has ever happened to people there. It happened to me once upon a time. It's happened to a lot of parents we've counseled, and they show up and they go to the teacher, Johnny can't read. Well, you know, you're going to have to work a lot harder at home, Mrs. Allen. Okay, but Johnny still can't read. So what's my option? Now I go to the principal. How do I get another teacher? Oh, it's not the teacher, it's Johnny. Like, if you keep telling me it's my problem, I'm probably not going to show up and be engaged. If, however, you have the same conversation with a school that can actually do something, the conversation will probably go with, well, let's look at it. Let's do an assessment. Is there an issue? What can you do at home? What can we do here? Maybe we actually do have to change around the way we do things. In a traditional public school, it is not that the rules are so fixed against it. It is the culture is set the way things are, and teachers are so accustomed to being measured and traced on the certain way they do things that they don't have the, not the capacity, but the wherewithal to get to where you need to be to tailor and personalize that environment. So you want to engage parents, create those autonomous schools with backpack funding in a brand new reset stage that has rural communities. I tied them all together, isn't that good?
Well done.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen very often. Okay, so let me ask you, switching gears a little bit, what is your position for public funding for early childhood education? We're about to have that debate here in Idaho. What are the best reforms you've seen regarding channeling funds to early childhood?
You know, there's a lot of great data about early childhood now, and like everything, it's not a panacea, right? The best programs to stimulate early childhood education are also choice-based. Not everybody wants it. Not everybody feels that they need it. Not everybody wants the same from early childhood education. So some people might want something that's much more play. Some other people might want something that's accelerated. The biggest mistake we make is saying that money should go to a traditional school district for early child education, and the traditional school district, who, by the way, we're trying to reform, should do the job. It sort of reminds me of the discussion years ago under No Child Left Behind when we started supplemental services. So very little known fact. It's well known in Washington now. But supplemental services were that tutoring. Many of you know about the tutoring dollars. If you weren't doing a great job, your child would have the opportunity to go to a school and be tutored. And Arne Duncan, then superintendent of Chicago, said, give me the money, and I'll do the tutoring. And all of us were like, why would you give him the money? Chicago's doing a lousy job, and you're going to give him the money to do after-school tutoring? It's sort of my same philosophy. By the way, he did get the money. And now he's Secretary of Education, go figure. But the reality is not every school is equipped to do early childhood education. Everyone should have the opportunity to have their child having services. But in Georgia, it's a choice. There's a voucher. And nobody talks about that B word in Georgia, but it is a voucher, and poor people actually use the voucher, and they go to community centers, and they go to churches. I'd like to extend it and say you can actually go to a home. I think there should be accountability again, but I think you can't put a cookie-cutter model of early childhood education on a state when you're trying to actually reset everything else.
Okay, you lead me to another reset question. We've had you alluded to our last election with regard to Propositions 1, 2, and 3. A couple of the questioners are asking things along the lines of how do we reset or start a revolution in education given that recent history? And how do we engage parents to get involved in that, given that they may have been emotionally involved in the election?
So I have a couple of thoughts about that election, which I know Mike will be really interested to hear from me about. One is that really most of the conversation was up here. And when people are scared or when people are worried, they vote certain ways. It's really hard to get people to change policy at the ballot box. People don't feel comfortable changing policy at the ballot box. So I really think that it goes back to engaging people. If you get people on board to understand exactly what the reforms are, if you get real rank and file parents, teachers, and folks at the level of discourse early on, it's a lot easier to vote for something or support something when you've actually been touched by it. And I think many of us make the mistake of assuming because something makes perfect sense. I am a supporter of 1-2. I'm a supporter of those initiatives. I was not a supporter of 1-2 and 3 to repeal them. Let me rephrase that. And I really, nothing I saw coming out, as great as the efforts were on both sides, nothing I saw coming out was accurate on either side. Just saying. Or wasn't comprehensive enough. And so I think that if you're battling for my vote, you need to do a better job of explaining to me why something I should do or shouldn't do something.
Okay, we have a lot of questions with very few time left.
Sorry.
I'm going to call this our last one. And Jeannie will actually be around, so we're going to get this question answered. What would you say the first steps we need to take to here in Idaho to get this sort of thing going? First steps.
For the whole thing or data or what? What kind of, what?
Take your pick.
Take your pick? Yeah. Oh my gosh. I think the first step is really to initiate and have a couple of really smart ideas drawn up that say this is where we're going, and then you build the strategy from there. This is what we need to do with our data. This is what we need to do to expand choices. This is what we need to do to make sure that we're not interfering with those choices. This is what we need to do to get to the heart of, you know, how to change the way district politics are and get districts on board. And then it's going to be a battle. And people have to understand they're involved in that, that it's going to be a battle. And there'll be tension. And it may mean that some of your friends don't talk to you. And okay, oh well, it's our kids. And they'll come back later when they see it works.
I'm going to wrap this up now, which I would rather not do. We've got a lot more questions to be answered, I know. So please hang around. Jeannie will be around as well after the talk. So let's first give her a big round of applause for coming.
Thank you. My pleasure.
My plug for next month's education ed sessions event here, we've got Adrian Sanier from Arizona State University. He's a guy who's been in Idaho already working with higher ed leaders and some of what we call Idaho's hacker population, who's going to talk to us about re-engineering higher education. We typically talk K through 12 here at Ed Sessions, but this will be a different sort of show next April. You can check it out on the edsessions.org website. You'll hear more about Adrian. And again, let's please thank Jeannie Allen for being here today. We are adjourned.